Random House Audiobooks presents The Forest by Edward Rutherford, read for you by Lynn Redgrave.
The Forest, 1099. The deer started. She trembled for a moment, then listened. A grey-black spring night still lay like a blanket over the sky. Along the edge of the wood, in the damp air, the peaty scent of the heath beyond mingled with the faint mustiness of last year's fallen leaves. It was quiet, as if the whole island of Britain were waiting for something to happen in the silence before the dawn. Then, suddenly, a skylark started singing in the dark. Only he had seen the hint of paleness on the horizon. The deer turned her head. Something was approaching. Puckle made his way through the wood. As his feet brushed the leaves or snapped a twig, he might have been mistaken for a badger, wild pig, or some other denizen of the forest. Puckle. It was one of those strange old names that grew mysteriously out of the English landscape. When he and his family had been kicked out of their hamlet by the servants of the new Norman king, they had wandered across the forest and finally set up a ramshackle camp by one of the streams that ran down to the River Avon at the forest's western edge. Recently, they had moved several miles south to another stream. Puckle was thick-set, gnarled like an oak, his powerful shoulders stooped forward as though he was in the habit of pulling some great weight. Sometimes when the firelight caught his oaken face in its reddish glow, he looked like a goblin. Yet the children would cluster round him when he came to the hamlets to make gates or wattle fences, which he did better than anyone else. Women found themselves strangely drawn to some deep inner glow they sensed in the woodsman. The forest animals hardly troubled to avoid him, almost as if they sensed that he was one of them. The deer had wandered a little apart from the rest of the group, who were still feeding peacefully in the new spring grasses near the woodland edge. She was a fallow deer. There were three kinds of deer in the forest. The great red deer, with their russet brown coats, were the ancient princes of the forest. Then, in certain corners, there were the curious roe deer, delicate little creatures, hardly bigger than dogs. Recently, the Norman conquerors had introduced a new and lovely breed, the fallow deer. She was nearly 2 years old. Like almost all fallow deer, she had a white rump and black-fringed white tail. But for some reason, nature had made her coat a little paler than was usual. She was a pretty animal. This year, at the autumn rutting season, she would find a mate, as long as the hunters did not kill her. Horses snorted. Men stamped their feet. The hounds panted impatiently. The smell of horse and wood smoke permeated the yard. It was time to go hunting. Adela watched them. A dozen men had already gathered, the huntsmen in green, with feathers in their caps, several knights and squires from the area. She had pleaded hard to be allowed to ride with them, but her cousin Walter had only grudgingly agreed when she reminded him, "At least I shall be seen. You are supposed, you know, to be finding me a husband." It was not easy for a young woman in her position. Only a year had passed since her father had died. Her mother had entered a convent. "It preserves my dignity," she told Adela as she entrusted the girl to her relatives, thus leaving her with nothing but her good name and a few dozen poor acres in Normandy to recommend her. The relations had done their best for her, though, and it had not been long before their thoughts had turned to the Kingdom of England, where, since the Norman Duke William had conquered it, many sons of Norman families had found estates, sons who might be glad of a well-born wife from their native land. "Of all your kinsmen," she was told, "your cousin Walter Tyrrell is the best place to help you. He made a brilliant marriage himself." Walter had married into the mighty family of Clare. Their estates in England were huge. The yard where Adela waited was typical of the Saxon manors in the region. Large timber, barn-like buildings with thatched roofs surrounded it on three sides. In the centre, the great hall was marked by an elaborately carved doorway and an outside staircase to reach the upper floor. "Here they come!" A shout went up as a movement at the door of the hall indicated that the leaders of the party were about to emerge. Walter came first, then a squire, then the man they were waiting for, Cola. Cola the huntsman, lord of the manor, master of the forest. He was silver-haired now, his long, drooping moustache grey, but he was still a splendid figure. His athletic frame might not be lithe any longer, but he walked with the grace of an old lion. He was every inch a Saxon noble. It was not Cola, however, at whom she found herself staring. It was his son who followed just behind him. In his 20s, she estimated, he was tall and handsome, with long blonde hair, a short beard, and bright blue eyes. He walked lightly, athletically, with such an air of noble breeding that she instinctively felt glad that these Saxons, at least, had kept their manner, unlike the many others who had lost out to her own people. A few minutes later, just as the sun was tipping over the oak trees on the horizon, the whole party, some 20 of them, moved off. Their destination lay just over the eastern ridge of the Avon Valley, and part of the reason why she had begged to go that day was the chance to explore this wild region about which she had often heard. For this was King William the Conqueror's new forest. Forest, a Norman term. It did not mean woodland, although huge woods lay within its borders, but rather an area set apart for the king's hunting. And since the Norman Conqueror had only recently taken the region for his own, the place was called New Forest. The area William took for his New Forest was a huge wedge. From west to east, it stretched from the Avon Valley, almost 20 miles across, to a great inlet that came in from the sea. From north to south, it descended gently for over 20 miles in a series of gravelly shelves, from the chalk ridges east of the castle of Sarum all the way down to a tract of wild marshland on the coast of the English Channel. It was a mixed terrain, a great patchwork of heath and woodland, grassy lawn and bog, over which little bands of men had wandered, settled, made clearances and departed for so many thousands of years that it was no longer possible to decipher with any certainty whether any patch of the landscape was fashioned by the design of God or the cruder hand of man. Most of the land was peaty and acidic, and therefore poor, but here and there were tracts of richer soil which could be cultivated. The greatest oak woods lay in the southern basin, often on boggy ground, and had probably not been disturbed for over 5,000 years. The presence of the sea was felt in the salty scent that carried over the land on warm southeasterly breezes. But the sea itself was nearly always hidden until one came out of the oak woods onto the coastal marshes. One visible sign there was, however, for opposite the eastern part of the forest's shore and divided from it by a 3-mile channel known as the Solent Water, rose the friendly hump of the chalky Isle of Wight.
"Stop daydreaming, you'll get left behind."
"Sorry," Adela said, and they went forward, Walter trotting officiously at her side. With his small, curling moustache and slightly stupid pale blue eyes, how did Walter manage to insinuate himself everywhere? Probably because, even though he had no special talent, it was clear that he was doggedly determined to make himself useful to the powers that be. Not a bad fellow to have in the family in these uncertain times. For there were always political intrigues going on in the Norman world. When King William the Conqueror had died a dozen years before, his inheritance had been divided between his sons. William, known as Rufus, got England. Normandy had gone to Robert. A third son, Henry, received only an income. While Rufus was a competent ruler, Robert was not, and it was often said that Rufus would take over Normandy one day. The situation was further complicated by the fact that so far, Neither Rufus nor Robert had married and produced an heir. The party was making swift progress across the heath. Cola and his son led the way. Run by several foresters, some of them Saxons, like Cola, left in place because of their intimate knowledge of the area, the forest kept a stock of about 7,000 deer. When one of the royal huntsmen led a party out to kill deer for the king, as Cola was doing today...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.